The last time three U.S. aircraft carriers operated at the same time in the Western Pacific, the U.S. was trying to deter North Korea from its nuclear weapons program. The rare incident is now happening again, but this time, USS Nimitz, Theodore Roosevelt, and Ronald Reagan were there because of China.
While the Chinese Communist Party ramps up its disinformation campaign to try to shift blame and burnish its image, we continue to see aggressive behavior by the PLA in the South China Sea.
The PLA has escalated border tensions. We see them today in India, the world's most populist democracy. We watch as it militarizes the South China Sea and illegally claims more territory there, threatening vital sea lanes.
Since 2015, the Chinese regime has built man-made islands, militarizing them with airports, aircraft, and missiles. The area is of great global importance. Nearly a third of the world's maritime trade passes through this area of water. It is the lifeline for important U.S. allies like Korea and Japan, who import over 90% of their crude oil through this route. Meanwhile, beneath the ocean is buried over 10 billion barrels of oil and almost 200 trillion cubic feet of natural gas, although one Chinese regime-owned oil major put the figures much higher. International law says that every country can claim an exclusive economic zone extending up to 200 nautical miles for activities like drilling or fishing. But China claims Beijing reaches as far as 1,200 miles from the south of mainland China, including areas very close to the coast of Malaysia, the Philippines, and Vietnam. In 2016, the Hague International Tribunal concluded that there was no legal basis for China's claim to the territory. And for years, the U.S. has navigated its warships through the area to show that it is not recognizing China's claim. But none of this has stopped China from continuing to build man-made islands and militarizing them.
But Beijing says it won't abide by the court's decision and refuses to scale back its economic and military presence in the area.
Meanwhile, experts say Washington's failure to confront Beijing has left some U.S. allies in the region in difficult positions and unsure whether or not to continue challenging an increasingly aggressive China. But this year's pandemic is changing that. The Pacific pivot, as promised by three U.S. administrations to its Asian allies, might finally become reality. Earlier this month, the Senate Armed Service Committee approved a $6 billion military fund to establish the Pacific Deterrence Initiative. It requires the Defense Department to build more smaller but more flexible bases in the region to counter China's potential missile strike and increase information sharing among allies in the region. The committee summary said that the fund will focus resources on key military capabilities to deter China, while it will also reassure U.S. allies and partners and send a strong signal to the Chinese Communist Party that the American people are committed to defending U.S. interests in the Indo-Pacific. Meanwhile, the Senate committee pressed a hot button by proposing an invitation to Taiwan in this year's Pacific Maritime Exercises in August, the biggest joint drill in the world. The once every 2 years exercise has in the past invited nearly all Indo-Pacific countries except for North Korea and Taiwan. Even Russia participated once in 2012. China was also invited to participate in the exercise in 2014 and again in 2016. But in 2018, the Trump administration excluded China for its coercive behavior in the South China Sea. This year's potential invitation to Taiwan may signify a bipartisan willingness to reconsider U.S. military relationships with China and Taiwan.
There is a change of situation. Part of the reason is the regional tension caused by the CCP virus. The U.S. Navy's recent mobilization, the behaviors recently by its allies and the U.S. Indo-Pacific Command have shown that the most important thing is the Indo-Pacific region. From Northeast Asia along the East China Sea, the periphery of the Taiwan Strait to the Bashi Channel and the South China Sea, they are now strengthening alliances and increasing military power. The role of Taiwan has become increasingly important. Therefore, we still look forward to the Pacific Rim military exercise this year, and if Taiwan can be officially invited, that is another breakthrough.
During the 1950s to the 1970s, the U.S. and Taiwan were allies under the Sino-American Mutual Defense Treaty, agreeing that if one country came under attack, the other would aid and provide military support. In 1979, the Carter administration established diplomatic relations with Beijing and unilaterally annulled the treaty with Taiwan. Some of the treaty's content was carried over to the Taiwan Relations Act, which doesn't promise direct military assistance in case of an invasion by Beijing. Reporting by Penny Zhou, NTD News.